Hey, what's up? It's your girl, Neek, and you're tuned in to Neek at Night. And tonight, I'm going to be talking about R. Kelly's current manager. So I've interviewed the people from his past, but his current manager is now speaking out to the media that is in Chicago, and he is telling his sides of what he perceives this to all be. And I'm going to play that for you guys right now. So let me go on over to it.
He's ready, you know, to tell his side, which is important. No one's heard his side.
What's he saying?
I mean, he's got to, you know, tell everybody the truth. And you guys have been listening to one side of the story all these years. Now it's time to tell the other side.
Don, you talked to us outside court a little bit earlier today about some of the challenges he's faced in his life. You say that this is a result of bad choices, but not pedophilia.
That's not bad choices. I mean, he's a survivor. This is a young guy. This is a guy, an older man who was, at the age of 8, molested by his sister for 8 years. And who told him she would hurt, kill him if he told his mother. I mean, so you got to realize, I mean, that's your sister. Who goes, any of us have been through that? No. I mean, so you don't know what it feels like to go through that for 10 years of your life. It's in his book. He wrote the book, Solar Coaster. That's his book, and all this is in there.
So does that excuse any of the alleged behavior?
Absolutely not. It's alleged behavior, and that's because you're hearing from one side. I mean, but this is not a man who lets anybody in any of his events. This is not a man who I've ever seen go out and target a certain type of individual. Take my glasses off so I can see
it. I'm saying he's never targeted young people.
That's not him.
But to what you were saying he was young and his sister was that age. Does he feel...
His sister was 10 years older than him.
Right, a teenager.
Right.
But I'm saying
perhaps
it's the age of his alleged victim.
Right. Say it again?
But that's about the age of his alleged
victim. Yeah, I mean, so what should be... Who he should be in the room with? The psychiatrist, not police. I mean, you know what I mean? And we know how the industry is. If you snort coke, they're going to put that in front of you. If you like women, they're going to put that in front of you. He doesn't card anybody coming to his events.
So the allegations are a very, very young girl.
Yeah, but these are women that, I mean, you got to think about this. Rob, you know, when you go, dyslexic, we know about his issues with his, with not being properly educated and things of that nature. He wasn't going to that school because he was targeting somebody. He had a teacher, Lena McGlynn, who actually taught him how to play the piano and taught him about music and a lot of things. So he wasn't going there targeting anybody. He was going there to learn more about his craft. He's perfected his craft.
Did he have sex with 14-year-old girls?
Absolutely not. That's not what this man went into anything to do. Is he hypersexual? Now, that's a question you ask him. But that didn't stem from him being someone that goes out to do that. What happened to him put him in that position. You're 8 years old. Somebody's taking advantage of you. What do you think is going to happen as a result to that?
My question is, did he have sex with 14-year-old girls willingly or unwillingly?
Absolutely not. I mean, I can say that without my... I lost my daughter. I mean, so for me to sit here and think that somebody... I'm going to be around somebody who's targeting young women, I'm not going to do that. I mean, so, you know, for the fact of the matter is, he's not the person that these women that are out here targeting men of high stature to validate themselves. That's just not who he is.
What about the videos?
The videos exist, but you think about this. Back in those days, Mike Tyson went to jail for what? Because he can prove what happened in that room, right? So he's not taking videos because he gets something out from it. He can have sex every day if he wanted to. He's R. Kelly. So you got to think about that. The only way to prove that it was consensual, maybe it would have been taken. He wasn't, that's not what he chose to do. That's what he was advised to do on something like that. I mean, so he's not a bad person. He's not the monster that everybody's portraying him to be. And you got to think about the agenda of those folks that are targeting him right now. It's two sides to the equation. Everybody's focused on him, but they're not looking at the alleged survivors.
Do you think this is extortion? Done? Is that what you think?
Do the research. I mean, you got, Ashanti McGee. He's got 7 felonies for extortion, for bribery, for theft. Why is her rap sheet not in question right now? Why is she not the person that people are looking at and thinking that she may have extorted him? As some of the other cases of Johanda. Pace, who's never been married, produce a marriage certificate. Why did she lie about her last name?
You brought something up about a letter or a document that came your way asking for $50,000 or something.
Yeah, that's the latest quote-unquote victim. She sent the letter to Melvin, which was his attorney in the eviction order, asking for money before she went public with her statement. And we didn't respond to that. And as a result of that, there's now a lawsuit. If you read the lawsuit, I mean, she stated a lot of different things. You guys have greater research than I can ever do. Do the research on the accusers. I mean, that's just really what I'm saying.
You said something about R. Kelly being scared.
Wouldn't you be?
I'm asking him, how's he doing? He said, right now.
Okay, so as you can see, that is his current manager speaking. And honestly, I feel like he probably shouldn't have said anything. Let the lawyer speak, because I don't know if he helps at all. I was looking at it and I was like, you know, I don't know about what you're saying, but I get it. Like, I get what he's saying about certain accusers that, you know, have rap sheets and things like that. But the way he explains R. Kelly being like hypersexual, and I mean, I guess I don't think that he thoroughly conveys his thoughts. I think what he was trying to say, maybe, I don't know, but it didn't sound good the way he said it. I think what he was trying to say was the women wanted to be with R. Kelly. So, you know, because he said that they targeted him. So I believe he's saying, like, you know, the women wanted to be with R. Kelly, and it's not a situation where R. Kelly is the one who targeted them. I think that's what he's saying. Which, I mean, to that part of it, I can agree with a lot of the victims, the women who have come forward, like Asante. I interviewed her husband, and he talked about how, you know, she spent his money to go and to make sure she was able to be, like, in the VIP at certain clubs of R. Kelly's. And, you know, she went several times to several events and several venues until she was able to meet him. We've seen, I believe it was Geronda, who stopped out the trial, and she, like, you know, made it a purpose to meet him. So when he says, like, you know, the women targeted him, that part of it I agree with. But even though I feel like there are a large amount of the women who spoke out who targeted and baited him, I'm able to look at it from both sides. So I'm able to, you know, think in my head, like, okay, well, yeah, they did target him, but yet, you know, that doesn't mean that he did not violate them. Because say you meet a guy at a bar, and, you know, you think he's cute, that doesn't give him the right to, like, punch you in the face type of thing. The reason why I felt like they were not victims were things that they admitted from their own mouths. So, like, when they were talking about the things that happened and when they described certain things, to me, it didn't sound like, oh, I'm a victim. It sounded like I was in a relationship with him, I didn't like how things ended up, and I got mad. Now, let's move focus to the actual part that I feel like he may be guilty of. Now, if he has a situation with a 14-year-old girl, then he needs to go to jail, suffer the consequences, and he needs to have his day in court. But my only thing was, I've always felt like he should have a fair trial and his fair day in court. So his manager says the tapes exist. You know, it depends on the nature of what is actually on the tape that will convict him or not convict him. And if he is on the tape, because Avenatti gave, like, dialogue of what is maybe on the tape. Now, if he's actually on the tape with a 14-year-old and he's saying, hey, give me this 14-year-old booty and stuff like that, and it's an actual 14-year-old on the tape and it's not him, like, role-playing or whatever, then get him the fuck out of here. But I didn't want to just jump off of what Avenatti said, because I, in my own personal opinion, I couldn't imagine if they had this tape, they showed it to the grand jury, and it's in fact a 14-year-old girl, and he's saying, let me get this 14-year-old booty. In my mind, when I thought of that, I'm like, okay, well, why was he able to release bail if that's what is in fact on the tape? So that's why I was always skeptical of it, you know, and I'm able to be skeptical until I get more information. If more information comes out and it proves, yes, the tape exists, yes, the girl's 14, yes, 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 this, then get him the fuck out of here. Let him serve his time in jail. Let him do his time. So I just want to be clear on that, because although I don't think that the older women are victims, I don't agree with men having sex with underage girls at that age. You know what I'm saying? Now, if you are a 17-year-old girl and you lie and say that you're 19 or whatever, to me, I view that differently. Like me, I'm a person, I view everything on a case-by-case basis. When I hear about Geronda and I hear about her going to trial and I hear about her lying about her age, to me, that says, hey, maybe this girl isn't a victim, but that does not excuse him in messing with her, because he should be checking for her identification to make sure she is of legal age. But I look at it as a case-by-case situation by saying, I don't think that she's a victim, but what he's guilty of, and the women who are victims, you know, convict him for that. Now, when it comes to a 14-year-old being on tape, and again, like I said, once we verify the context, because his manager says, hey, the tapes do exist. You know, he didn't confirm the context of the tapes. But I'm a person that, you know, even if I'm skeptical, I'm not going to be oblivious. Like, if there's new information that comes out and it changed my skepticism, then it's going to change my skepticism to an actual fact. I'm a person who I'm not going to jump on just because Avenatti says something, because to me, it didn't make sense. If you got this tape, if you got this stuff, why he getting bail? So I was skeptical. But if his manager is saying the tapes do exist, and if the context of it does align with what Avenatti says, then, you know, I'm able to change my mind and be like, okay, well, this, and this, and this is a fact, and this ain't a fact. I'm not going to take everything as a fact just because somebody says it. When new information comes out, I'm able to assess the new information and change my mind. As far as all of the women that he's dealt with, I don't think that all of them are victims. I feel like, you know, and that's not just solely me not thinking that they're all victims, because I feel like, you know, certain women baited him. That's Chicago law as well. So if Azriel is 17 and she starts dating him and she's of the consenting age according to Chicago law, that's a situation where I look at it as a case by case thing. When her parents talk about her going with R. Kelly, that I believe they said that when she actually left was when she was 18 years old. So if she's 18 years old, you know, I can't say, okay, we'll throw him under the jail for something where the law says that that is what he is able to do. And I know that there are girls who are 18 who go and they grow and they get 18 and they decide that they want to be grown and they want to live their own lives and they don't want to listen to their parents. I'm not going to throw him under the bus for what I know could be a reasonable situation. And not to say reasonable as in it's okay morally, because a grown-ass man should have no interest in an 18-year-old. But I'm just saying, if that's the law and I've seen it happen, I know that what is happening with her is not something so out of the norm and crazy, then I'm going to look at it on a case-by-case thing and I'm going to say, hey, she was 18 years old, she was grown, her parents put her in this position, and, you know, this is a case-by-case thing. I look at each person who has come out in regards to R. Kelly on a case-by-case basis. As I get information, I assess it, and I look at certain things differently. I don't want to keep rambling on and on and on. I just kind of want to make those things clear. The things that he's guilty of, throw him in jail. The things that he's not guilty of, I think there has been a blurred line and the things are being blurred together. And for me, I know how to separate what's okay, what's not okay, what he's guilty of, what he's not guilty of, and put it on the table. If there's new information, I'm able to change my mind and change the way that I feel about it, you know, and go from there. So, you know, his manager has spoken out. He says that R. Kelly is ready to speak out. I'm interested to see what R. Kelly has to say. Is he going to dig himself deeper? Are we going to understand his perception? You know, or are we going to understand? I don't know. At that time, I'm able to look at it when it comes out and I'm going to give my honest opinion on it. If I look at it and I feel like, you know, the way I've thought is different or this, I have a different perception, I'm going to share with you guys my perception of what it is I see. There are people who, you know, he needs to serve his consequences for. And then there are people who I think are just attaching their name to a narrative. And I feel like some of the lines are blurred. And I feel like, you know, a lot of the people, because they were violated as youth, because a lot of the comments are, I'm a survivor, I'm a this, I'm a that. And I think that a lot of people are, you know, acting or they're feeling off of emotion when it comes to some of this, because they were abused and they're taking their situations as facts in his situation. And, you know, so, but I just look at it differently. If the manager say the tape exists, the tape exists. If the context matches what Avenatti says, then, you know, I can now assess that and say, okay, now this is a fact. If Avenatti just says something and it don't make sense to me, I'm gonna be skeptical until the pieces are put together and it starts to make sense. Regardless of what we know about R. Kelly, some of this stuff that these women are saying, some of these new accusers, some of these new people,
their stories don't make sense. So even though I know that R. Kelly has this infatuation with young girls, I'm not going to be oblivious and just take everything that everybody says and run with it. That's just not me. But let me not ramble on. I want to know what you guys think about what this manager is now saying. And I've talked way more than I wanted to talk on this, but it is what it is. I want to know what you feel about what the manager is saying. What do you think about all of this stuff going forward? And within you giving your opinion, be respectful, because we can agree to disagree without you being disrespectful. A lot of y'all will come in the comments and be extremely disrespectful, and it's unwarranted. I don't have to agree with you, and you don't have to agree with me, but what we can do is respect each other's opinion and agree to disagree, and then you can give your opinion on what you feel. Period. But with that being said, again, that's all for this video. If you're not subscribed to my channel, be sure to subscribe to my channel, because whatever the information is, I'm gonna give my honest opinion on it. Period. Regardless, I'm gonna give my honest opinion. So, all right, guys, that's it. Subscribe, like, comment, but be respectful. And if you made it to the end, I want you to put a half moon emoji in the comments and then pair with another emoji. And so, oh no, actually, you know what? Half moon emoji and french fry emoji. Throw them off, because the people who would, they see that I normally say put emoji at the end, if they see people in the comments putting emojis, they're going to just put emojis and not. Half moon emoji, french fry emoji, comment and let me know what you think. And that way I know that you made it to the end if you have the half moon emoji and a french fry. And you know, I fuck with you for rocking with me and listening to what I have to say and then saying what you gotta say. All right, guys, peace.